Oh yeah. At the age of five, my mother said I was gonna be the greatest man alive. But now I'm a man, way past 21. I want you to leave me, baby. I have lots of fun. I'm a man.
Are we going?
Source.
Are we going, guys? Somebody give me a ping on the chat there. Just want to make sure we're going. Okay, looks like we're going. So, hey, welcome to the little cooking class with Kent Rathbun and the Observer Magazine. Hey, this is going to be a lot of fun. I have to tell you, man, we've had a great turnout for this. There's over 300 people watching right now, and makes me a little nervous. I want to kind of go through a couple of things to make sure that everybody has a little bit of an understanding of how we're going to do this. This will probably last 45 minutes to an hour. We're going to do some barbecue. It's a beautiful time outside and, you know, beautiful day to be outside. So here's what we're going to do. And we're going to do some ribs today. So I want to talk to you about my curbside barbecue. So if you haven't checked out the curbside barbecue, it is chefkentrathbun.com. And you can go to curbside barbecue and check out what we're doing. We're doing pickups on Saturday, Sunday between 2 and 4 at Lover's Seafood Market. And occasionally we're doing pop-ups around the city. So I kind of just want to say that you know, this is my first Dallas Observer at Home series class, so we're really excited to be here, and I hope everybody can hear me and see me okay. And if we're not broadcasting correctly, maybe shoot a text in someone, but I think we're going okay. So I also want to say that this benefits the Dishing Out Relief, which is an organization that is put on with the Texas Restaurant Association to sort of help restaurant workers, chefs, waiters, busboys, all kinds of hospitality workers around the state because of this crazy time we're in. You know, we've all been very affected by this. So this is going to be a great thing. We've already raised a pretty good amount of money for this charity, so thank you so much for that. Also, I kind of want to remind you guys about the 10th annual Iron Fork coming up on August 12th. And this is going to be fun because I have been the MC for this pretty much the entire time. I think I might have skipped one or two years. But the Iron Fork is a great, great event. It's fantastic restaurants, fantastic chefs from all over the city are there. And I mean, it's a food and wine and beer sort of festival. It's fantastic. And then we have a little Iron Chef competition between two of Dallas's most famous chefs. So don't forget that on August 12th. So I want to tell you a little bit more about the curbside barbecue because it brings me to our recipe. So when this crazy stuff started, we started doing, you know, to go like many restaurants, and we started doing the Rathbun curbside barbecue at Lover Seafood. So if you haven't ordered from us, check it out. Everything is pre-order online. We pick up Saturday, Sunday between 2 and 4, and we're doing some cool stuff. Not only ribs and chicken and brisket, but we're also doing lobster tails. We're doing Wagyu strips. We're doing smoked salmon sides on cedar planks. I mean, it is really, really fun. So we're going to do a recipe today that kind of is in that same program. And this is kind of what I like to do at home cooking. Now, I thought I'd do this recipe a little more geared toward the average home cook that might not have a smoker. So I want to tell you that I have a beautiful grill back here from Lynx, and I want to teach you how to set it up to smoke ribs on it or smoke anything on it for that matter. And I'm going to give you a few tips about how to set the smoker up. So let's get started. So number one, you want to make sure that you always light your smoker or light your grill in plenty of time. Okay. So in this case, we have a grill, gas grill. We turned it on. We turned it on pretty high. We got it burning off the grill a little bit, and then we went to the second step, which is clean the grill. So we used a nice grill brush to clean it up. And by the way, the earlier you set it up and the hotter that it goes, the more it burns off the carbon from last time you used it. So it's a good way to sort of clean it up and get it ready to go. So step number three would be clean the grill. And we usually clean the grill with a little bit of canola oil and an old towel. Just kind of moisten an old towel with some canola oil and rub over the grill and just making sure that it's very nice and lubricated, okay? In this case, what would happen then is we would turn it down because this is a process of kind of barbecuing and then smoking the ribs. So instead of just smoking the ribs, we're gonna do both. So we're gonna kind of grill them a little bit before we even get to the smoke part, okay? Actually, I think we'll get to the smoke part first. Let me show you one thing. So Lynx puts out this very cool little smoke box. And basically this deal is filled with wood chips. And it's got some pretty awesome combinations. And, you know, this is a Sonoma blend, so it's got hickory in it, but they have applewood, cherry, they got all kinds of different stuff. And what's really cool about this is it not only has chips, oh, look at that, it has charcoal. So now my hands are all messed up. Okay, so see, it happens to us even so, right? So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna close this up and we're gonna set this back on top of the grill right in here, all right? Now, as that heats up, what's gonna happen is those wood chips are gonna start smoldering and then they're gonna start throwing off some smoke. So you're gonna get some nice smoke. So we're gonna do that first. And now I think we're gonna set up our ribs, okay? So we're starting out with St. Louis style ribs. And by the way, this is one of my favorite ribs to do. I really enjoy these because they're so meaty. A lot of people like baby backs, but I'm kind of a St. Louis kind of chunky. I am from Kansas City, by the way. So, you know, there's a big discussion about how to start these ribs, and that is there's a membrane that runs on the back of these bones. And most chefs remove the membrane or they don't. I would say that most of them do, but some of them don't, and it's not a travesty if you don't. But I will tell you that there's a little sheet of dried sort of skin that develops on the back of the ribs if you don't pull these off. So I'm going to show you real quick how to do this. In fact, if we can maybe get a close-up of this rib right here. So if you can see right in here, this corner where this piece of skin is starting to fall off the bone, what we're going to do here is we're going to take a towel and we're going to pull this off just like this. What I'm doing underneath is I'm kind of pushing my finger up under there and I'm kind of deattaching this skin, okay? And it's a little tough, I'm going to say. It's not the easiest thing to pull off, but once you get it moving, then it goes pretty good. So watch this. So that's exactly the way that we want this to react, okay? We want this to pull completely off, all the way down, and then we're gonna just throw that away, okay? So now, the ribs are ready to be seasoned, and what I wanna do is I wanna start by showing you a few of my spices here. So I have a line of spices out that is now in Central Market, or will be soon. We have four. We have a steak and chop salt, which we'll be using today. We have sticky pig, which we'll be using today. And we have the barbecue rub, which we'll also be using today. The fourth one is a lemon pepper that's working great for this or chicken or anything else, but I think I'm gonna just go with the three that we have. And so what we're gonna do is we're gonna start off with the sticky pig, okay? And then the sticky pig is a kind of a really nice barbecue seasoning that's got quite a bit of sugar in it. So it's a little bit sweet, and it's got topinambit sugar and also a little bit of brown sugar. So now we're going to switch to the barbecue spice. And this has got all kinds of peppers, paprika, little smoked paprika. It's a fantastic little blend. And then we're going to use my steak and chop salt, which is simply kosher salt, garlic, and black pepper. So we're going to get this sprinkled on here really good, and then we're going to flip it, and we're going to do the same thing on the other side, okay? Let me wipe my hands off here. So notice that I'm seasoning these very, very evenly. Now, if you wanted to season these overnight, I would say that you could do that, but the one rub that you would want to stay away from for a 24-hour period would be the steak and chop salt. The sticky pig and the barbecue rub are really designed to be part of your overnight marinade, right? So it'll do just fine if you do it overnight. So we got our ribs skinned. We took the membrane off. We got them seasoned on both sides. Now what we're going to do is we're going to move to the grill, and we're going to do a little grilling of the rib, okay? So a lot of people saying, well, I usually put ribs right on a smoker and let them go. And that's fine, and we do that a lot too, but I want to tell you, I like the barbecued style. So what we're going to do is we're going to grill them a little bit on low heat. So come on over to the grill, and we'll check it out. All right, so in fact, I want to show you guys, if you can come in here and take a peek on this thermometer, we're running dead on 225, which is right where we want to be, okay? And the way I did this is I put the ribs on this side on the left, and I have one burner on the right running at very, very sort of medium level heat, okay? So let me show you what we got going on here. So we have our smoke boxes in here, creating a little bit of smoke, okay? And so those are right there. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take our ribs, and we're going to put them in here, and we're going to grill these just a bit. And we're just going to kind of let these go for a bit, okay? So you notice that I've got a couple more already going here. These are going to take anywhere from, 30 minutes to an hour before you even get them into the rib rack, and then you can turn down the oven or the grill and walk away a little bit, okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to switch over and make a little coleslaw, but during that time, we're going to let the ribs kind of cook, slow cook, and we're going to turn them a little bit back and forth, and we're also going to baste them, and I'll show you what we're going to do with that in just a second. Okay, so let me put this back over here. Okay, so now the next step here is we're going to make our baste, okay? And basically, I love vinegar bases, but I also love citrus. So what I have here is just one of our barbecue sauces, and this happens to be one of our honey teriyaki style barbecue sauce. It's got a lot of honey, teriyaki style, a lot of soy sauce, a lot of ginger, that kind of thing. So I'm taking the barbecue sauce, and I'm kind of mixing it up a little bit of a base, so it's about 3 or 4 to 1 of fresh orange juice, okay? So now we're just going to mix this up, and this is where we're going to brush our ribs with this about every 15 or 20 minutes, and then we're going to turn them. The idea with this is that lets the caramelization start to happen on the orange juice, and it's just it's really going to create a nice crust and a nice edge, okay? So let's move on to a slaw that we're going to do. So we're going to do a little apple coleslaw, okay? So we have a few things here I want to show you. So we have some Granny Smith apples. I love green apple. We have fresh cilantro. We have chayote squash, and I'm not sure if anybody has ever seen one of these, but down in New Orleans, when I worked there, we used to call this a merloton. And you see this in most grocery stores. I picked this up at Central Market today. It is a really beautiful vegetable. It's pear-shaped. A lot of people peel it, but you don't need to. It's got a bit of a seed in the middle, like almost like an avocado. And so we're going to julienne this along with the apple, the cabbage, and we're going to make a chayote squash and green apple slaw. So we also have nice red onion here. We have green cabbage and red cabbage. We have a little bit of a nice shallot here. And then I also have olive oil that I picked infused olive oil today. This is a jalapeno olive oil, so it's going to be a little spicy. And this is yuzu. So we're going to kind of take this slaw just a tiny bit Asian, And we could do that really quick by the yuzu juice. Yuzu is a Japanese citrus that's got a very, very unique flavor, and I love it. It's something that we use at Emoto and Shinsei quite often, and so it's really, really something special. So let's talk about how we're going to get started on this, okay? So the slaw's base is pretty much cabbage. So we're going to kind of get the cabbage moving first, okay? And what I've done is I've kind of cut off the side of a head of cabbage. And all of these are just, you know, they're all layered just like any other lettuce would be. So what we're trying to do here is we want to get a super thin julienne just like this, okay? And we're gonna just cut as thin as we can. And in fact, I'll tell you what I'm gonna do. We're gonna use the mandolin anyway, so we might as well see how this works on the mandolin. By the way, guys, if you've never used a mandolin before, mandolins are pretty sharp. So that does a better job than even I did. Look at that. Okay, so we're gonna just use that. And I always like to say that there's two types of chefs that have used the mandolin, and that is the ones that have been cut and the ones that will be. So mandolins are super sharp, so be very careful, okay? So now we're just gonna kind of set that aside. Now we have some beautiful green cabbage. All right, I'm gonna set that out here in the middle. And this is something that I think can happen while you're entertaining guests. You know, you don't have to have this ahead of time. You certainly can. It's easy to deal with, and it just refrigerates really, really well, okay? So now we're gonna use a similar cut of the red cabbage. And here we go, just down the mandolin, just like that. And guys, I have to tell you, please be careful here, because you can get cut big time here, okay? So we got enough here to get going, so I'm just going to kind of lay that to the side. So we're looking for some nice color here. We do have it, okay? All right, now, let's take a peek at our ribs real quick. If I can get you to pop over here with me. So let's take a look. So we're still running around just around 200 degrees. We want to be low and slow. All right. So now these are starting to cook. You're starting to see some smoke coming out of here. So now what we're going to do is we're going to turn these over and we're going to see that we've got a nice grill mark on these. Okay. But now check this out. So now we're going to come in and we're going to start basting with our barbecue sauce and orange juice based. And so remember that the sugar in the barbecue sauce and the sugar in the orange juice is now going to start cooking and caramelizing and flavoring on the ribs, okay? So I'm actually going to leave this over here for the next move that we make. And while we're here, we're going to go ahead and baste these. Look at how nice these look. These have been on here for a little while. These take a while, so... You know, I kind of wanted to make sure that we had some ready to go so that you guys could see how these look. All right, and they're looking really nice. What do you think? I don't know about you, but I'm looking at these thinking I'm ready for dinner. Okay, so now let's get back and let's start with our next vegetable, which is going to be a carrot. I've already got it peeled here. And what we're going to do now is we're just going to take this and we're gonna shave this down into just, you know, nice little slices like this, okay? So once we get this, I'm gonna set these aside. Once we get this, now we're gonna stack these up. And we are gonna use a knife here. And we are just going to do a very thin julienne, just like this. And these mandolins come with a set of teeth that run across here. So you could actually use those to give yourself a little julienne. But most of the time, especially on harder vegetables, I like to use my knife because I just feel like it's a little better, better control, okay? All right, now, let me clean up my board here. Okay, so now we have the mandolin. We're gonna set that aside. We're gonna hold off on the apple till the last moment because the apple ends up kind of getting a little bit oxidized if you cut it too early, until we put in the yuzu, which is a citrus, and that'll kind of keep it white. So this is a nice shallot. So what I'm going to do here is we're just going to cut this off. We're going to peel the end. All right. And we're just going to kind of peel off the outside just like this. All right. I wish you guys could smell these ribs, man, because I got to tell you, they're smelling pretty awesome. Okay, so now we're going to go back to our mandolin, and we're going to do a little shaved shallot in here, just like that. You don't need a whole lot of this, just a little bit of onion. All right, so we're just going to use that, just like that, and then that's going to go into our salad or into our slaw, just like that. All right, so look at the color, nice, right? Now we're going to use a little red onion too. Now this time, I'm going to show you a little technique on the onion. We could certainly slice the onion on the mandolin, but I think what we're going to do here is that we're going to do a little bit of a what I call a French onion cut. So if you've ever made French onion soup, or if you want to just see the best way to julienne an onion really nice, what we're going to do is we're going to take it and just cut it into sections like this, okay? And then we're going to take out the middle. And now we have this stack of perfectly little pieces of onion. Now, we're not going to throw that onion away because that's going to be really great for a sauce later down the road. Okay, and then what we're going to do here, now that we have this stacked up, we're going to just real thin julienne just like this. And what's nice about this is look how consistent this is, okay? I mean, that's what we want. We want to see this... We want to see this salad really beautiful, and we want to have nice cuts here. We always eat with our eyes first, so we want this to look great, right? All right, so now we're going to do one more little run through of this, just like that. All right, now I'm going to get this out of my way. We're going to slide this in here. All right, so now we have a nice looking slaw beginning, and we haven't even added our good stuff yet. So now we're going to go back to our mandolin, and we're going to slice our chayote just like this. All right. And you can see, look at how beautiful that is. And this is super crisp and tasty too. It's kind of a cross between a pear and maybe a jicama. It's, you know, sweeter at different parts of the year. And just so nice and crisp. Once again, we're going to stack these up, and then we're going to julienne these. So Jerry, we have any questions over there? What's going on? By the way, guys, Jerry's my sidekick. She's over there watching for anybody putting up any questions, and she'll probably have a couple questions on her own. So,
people, just to let you know, he has done this knife skills before. It's not his first time, so don't feel bad if yours don't look like this.
Come on.
He makes it look pretty easy.
Yeah, you know what? That's practice makes perfect. And by the way, good knives are helpful, right? Good knives are helpful. All right, so we're going to set this all aside here, get this out of my way. And one more time here. And we're just going to julienne real thin.
Hey, Kent.
Yes.
What was the name of that veggie pear thing again? Just asking.
Chayote. It's a chayote squash. And they call it merloton in the South, especially around New Orleans. And it is just super awesome. I really encourage you guys to go out and get one of these and use it in a slaw. I'll tell you something else. If you just took this thing and you know, this mandolin adjusts, so let me show you. It adjusts to a little thicker edge, okay? So it gets thicker here. So if you were to take that and now shave it into like pieces like this, what's great about this is a little bit of canola oil and some steak seasoning on the grill. This makes a fantastic grilled vegetable. In fact, you could do grilled chayote and pull it off, let it cool, julienne it, and do a chilled chayote squash slaw, which would be pretty awesome.
Hey, okay. Kent,
yes.
What kind of knives do you recommend for a home chef?
Well,
it's not going to go crazy.
Yeah. So for sure, I represent a company called Chroma, and the knives are designed by Porsche. Now, I love those knives, but I'm not trying to sell you these knives necessarily. I would tell you this. You want to buy knives that you're comfortable with. You want to buy knives that feel good in your hand, and you want to buy knives that are something that makes you want to cook. And so there's plenty of beautiful knives out there, but I will tell you that, you know, one of the things I always talk about are sort of the five pieces that you should have in a kit to begin with, okay? So one of the things, we need to check our ribs here. I need to check my ribs. Sorry about that. I was like looking at Jerry going, hey, it's getting smoky out here. Yeah, these are looking good. So one more time, we're going to come in and start basting this on the other side. Now, I think that these are at a point where we're going to go ahead and stack them in the rib rack. And what I want to show you about this little rib rack here is the greatest thing ever. Okay, this thing holds about 5 or 6 racks of ribs standing up. It's a great piece for your grill. And I'm telling you, it works really, really awesome. So check it out. You just kind of lay these up in here like this. And then they just stand up. And then every time you baste, it just kind of drips down the entire, you know, the entire rib all the way down to the bottom. And it makes a really nice... nice rib, and I'm going to tell you the other thing too. You can get more on at a time, which is great. Okay, let's move on over here back. We get back to our knives. So let's talk about the five pieces of knives that I think you should have in your collection, and that is you should definitely have a French knife like this. And a French knife is also called a chef's knife, and there's also Japanese versions of those. They're called santokus. And these knives are basically designed for this kind of use right here, this rocking motion, which is what we use about 90% of the time to cut. You can do that without hitting your knuckles on the ground. That's how you know, or on the cutting board, that's how you know that you have a French knife or a chef's knife. The other knife in your collection should be a serrated knife. The third knife should be a boning knife of some sort, so you can bone out chickens, fish, meats, things like that. A paring knife is always a necessity, and then something to sharpen these knives with. So this particular knife is designed to be sharpened with a sharpening stone, which means that there's a little bit of a learning curve on that, and you shouldn't necessarily use it with other kinds of sharpening devices. Some knives are designed to be used on sharpening steels or sharpening devices that they provide. So you want to make sure that whatever knife you're buying, that you look into the manufacturer's suggested method of sharpening and follow that, because, you know, beautiful knives are really artwork, and that's another thing that you want to make sure of, is that, you know, you want to take care of them. And if you buy a nice set of knives, they should last you for the rest of your life, okay? So these are made by Porsche. I love them. I have them on my website at chefkentrathbun.com, but there's also many, many, many fantastic companies out there that do some really beautiful stuff. Okay.
Hey, Kent, we have a couple questions that go back to a few things we've already done.
So, sure.
I was just letting you finish the knife discussion first. Membrane off the ribs, correct?
Well, and again, we're doing that, but yes, I think that that should come off. But in lieu of that, I will tell you that, you know, many of you remember that I used to own and operate Jasper's restaurants, and we were pretty famous for our ribs. And we served hundreds of racks of ribs every day. Okay. And I got to tell you that we had so many ribs that we just could not keep up with pulling the membrane. So we took a knife and went down the backside of the bone on every single bone. Believe it or not, we had guys that could do that super fast, way faster than trying to pull the membrane. And what that allows is when you cut that membrane down the back of the bone, it allows it to pull as the meat starts to tighten, as it cooks. It allows it to pull away from the bone and let it come off of the bone a little more easy. So it's not a necessity to do the membrane thing, but I would suggest it. And I have to tell you that once I started doing it, it got better and easier and easier and easier for me. And I think it will for you too. So.
And then the barbecue sauce. What were the measurements again? on making.
So this little base is like a 4-to-1 on the barbecue sauce. So, you know, whatever your favorite barbecue sauce is, it's, you know, let's say it's a half a cup to 2 cups of citrus juice. And we've done it with orange juice. We've done it with, you know, grapefruit juice. If you do it with vinegar, you know, there's all kinds of vinegars. I mean, red wine vinegar, champagne vinegar, apple cider vinegar. Anything like that is definitely going to be okay. It's just kind of a flavor profile that you're going to have to kind of pick. But remember, what it's doing is it gives you a little caramelization from the orange juice and from the barbecue sauce. So that sugar that is in those sauces or those juices begins to caramelize on the ribs, okay? So now we've got our ribs in the rack, and now this is when they're going to be in the grill at about 225 to 250 for the next 2 to 3 hours. And what we're going to do is we're just going to let them cook really, really slow. And as I said, I've got a couple in there that are pretty close. And when we get ready to show you, I'm going to show you what you're looking for as the ribs start to get done. So let's finish up our slaw. Okay. Any more questions?
A couple.
Okay.
The mandolin. We talked about knives.
Yeah.
Any specific mandolin that you would suggest? Or?
Well, so these are Japanese mandolin. You know, when I first started cooking in a French restaurant in Kansas City, we used a metal one. It was a French mandolin. Very expensive. The blades were, you know, expensive to replace. This thing's about $30. Once it starts to get a little dull, throw it away, get a new one. That's how you do that, okay? But remember that these things are super, super, super sharp. These little screws right here will hold the blade that comes up, and it'll have the teeth. So you have different size julienne. And so that's what you'll have as you slide down. You'll be not only cutting it from one surface, but you'll be cutting it in different directions. So you can have everything from a pretty thick julienne to a very, very, very thin julienne. But those teeth in that mandolin, they do get clogged up. And if they're not sharp, you could really hurt yourself trying to do that. So I hope that answers the question. All right, so now I do think it's time to cut our apple. Okay, so one of the things that I did, and I did mention it, but I'm going to mention it now, is that I put a bunch of cilantro leaves in here, just fresh cilantro leaves. The other thing I'm going to do before I put the apple in is I'm going to cut these stems off, okay? Just so everybody knows, we've had this cilantro washed and dried. You can dry it in a salad spinner, okay? But what I'm about to show you is don't throw the cilantro stems away. These have huge flavor. They have great crunch, great texture. So what I do is I just come in and just cut the cilantro stems almost like chives. And for this recipe, we're only going to need, you know, maybe a tablespoon or two. But that's kind of what we're looking to do right there. And we're going to put that right into the salad, and that's going to give us a really nice little crunch, okay? Now, when this gets ready to mix, we want to make sure that we're kind of ready for that. So we're going to go ahead and shave some apple real quick here. Oops, I got a little thick. We're going to gotta size this down a little bit.
Hey, Kent.
Yes.
These ribs are smelling phenomenal, by the way. I'm getting started here. But I have a couple questions about the grill while you're cutting apples.
Perfect.
Will you have to refill the smoke box while they're smoking, or will that last?
You could refill the smoke box. That's a great question. You know, when we use the big smokers, we're using logs, and logs sort of smolder for quite a long time. But I think that, and I can smell the smoke too, but as soon as you start to see the smoke kind of dissipating, then you can go ahead and add a few more chips. And remember, if you can remember to soak the chips overnight in water, they do last a little longer. They'll smolder. The other thing nice about that is it throws a little steam on the inside of the smoker, which is also very helpful. Okay?
And is the one side of your grill super hot while the other side sit at 200?
So,
is that how you did it?
So the left side where the ribs are sitting right now is completely off. The middle is completely off. The far right burner is on about medium, which gives me about a 225 to 250 degree temperature. And what it's done is it's turned the grill into an oven. And because the smoke box is on the top of the burner and smoldering the wood, now we have a smoker. So, And that's why I wanted to show this, because, you know, a lot of people have smokers, but some people don't. Some people just have a nice grill. And I kind of wanted to give you a little bit of an opportunity to see how to set your grill up as a smoker or as a roaster, right? Imagine we're in November. You got a turkey sitting over here where the ribs are with no direct heat underneath, and you got a smoke box in there, and you're running about, you know, 225 or 250, and you're smoking a turkey for Thanksgiving. It doesn't get any better than that. And so if you've never used your grill as an oven or as a roaster, think about it like that, because we do this all the time. It's a fantastic way to, you know, utilize your grill in a different way. And, you know, the Lynx grills are really great because they do turn down to really low temperature, and so you can get down to that 200 degrees or 225. I mean, I'm running right now just a little bit above 225, and that 225 to 250 is exactly where we want to be on these ribs. And, you know, the two that I had in here before we started, they've been on and going for 3 hours. So they do take a little while, but listen, low and slow, that's why we say that. It's the best way to go with barbecue. Slow it down, low temperatures, take a break, drink a beer. Thanks, community. Speaking of that, I don't know if you guys know, but we're doing a little combination deal with community beer here in Dallas. Actually, it's tonight, tomorrow night, and Saturday night. It's pretty cool. You can go on their website and check out a video that we did, a full meal paired with their beers. You sign up, you get a box of food. You go pick it up, and you cook along, and you heat it up, and you eat along and learn about the beers, and it's really a cool program. Probably a little late for tonight, but tomorrow we still have some spaces, and so do we have on Saturday, too. So, Jerry, where would they go, Jerry? Just the community beer website?
Community beer website. Yeah, it's perfect. Right on there, and the menu is delicious.
Awesome.
It's delicious. I got to taste it the other night. Newbie grill person, what kind of grill do you suggest? They've got some friends that have suggested a Komodo Joe or a Bull Grill.
Or a what?
Bull Grill. Bull.
I don't think I'm familiar with that. I'll tell you, the Komodo Joe is a great grill. If you're interested in doing, if you're interested in doing wood, charcoal, that kind of stuff, it's a great piece. I actually have one. If you are a stainless steel person and you like a fancy grill out in your kitchen and you want something that's going to be super convenient and super beautiful, that is going to be a Lynx. I can tell you that. This is my favorite stuff. In fact, my whole kitchen is outfitted by Lynx. I'm one of the chefs on a team of chefs with Lynx, so I have to divulge that information, but I wouldn't be there if I didn't love the products. Everything that I have is beautiful. Everything that I have gets a big workout, and everything that I have works really, really well. So this is the Lynx grill. We got all kinds of pizza ovens and all kinds of other stuff in here. It's so much fun to have a beautiful outdoor kitchen and be out here. Even though it's a little warm out here, I got the wind going a little bit. It's pretty nice. I wish you were here because the smell is insane. What other questions?
What is your favorite wood to smoke in?
Well, smoke with, so the I'm favorite so wood, right? You know, it kind of depends. I like hickory as a base, or oak as a base. In fact, at the Curbside Barbecue, we use hickory and oak as a base, but I always like to see some fruit woods be added. So I like peach, I like cherry, I love apple wood, pecan, I love pecan wood. And by the way, a lot of, you know, we're in Texas, so a lot of people think, well, I have a lot of mesquite. Let's do something with mesquite. And I have to tell you, mesquite is great to grill with, but I'm not sure if I think it's the best wood to smoke with. It's a little harsh, it's a little heavy, it burns very fast. And again, we're getting back to that low and slow idea. You want to make sure that everything's going real slow and just real mellow. And so mesquite's not like that. But on the other hand, a grilled steak over mesquite fire, I don't know if it gets any better than that. I mean, it's fantastic, but that's fast cooking. It's seared, it's crusty, it's fantastic. Okay. What else you got, Jerry?
Devil's River. What's it doing there? Did you drink it before you started this?
Well, I could.
Was that used for?
Actually, I got a little plan for that. we're going to, right when we get ready to pull the ribs off, I think I'm going to flame them a little bit with a little whiskey. I thought that one might be kind of fun. And, in fact, we're going to probably do that here in a second. But let me finish up our slaw. Okay, so this is yuzu juice. We use this. You can't always find fresh yuzu juice or fresh yuzus, and they're around, but they're hard to find. So we're just going to use a little bit of that. And then remember my jalapeno infused olive oil. We're going to do that really nice. And we just want to put enough of this in our bowl here to just kind of get it coated, okay? We're going to use a little bit of my steak seasoning in here, all right? And then I want to show you what we got over here. We got a nice little, platter we're going to serve this on. And so what we're going to do here, let me clean my board again. Okay, so we're just going to toss this together. And this is something that you want to make sure that you're tossing together right before you get ready to eat. So you can keep it in a bowl without putting the yuzu juice on it. But remember that, in fact, the olive oil is okay to keep on the salad for a bit. But you don't want to put the acid on it until right at the last minute, because whether it's lime juice, orange juice, lemon juice, yuzu juice, vinegar, it starts to cook your vegetables right away. And so you don't want to mess that up, right? So look at this beautiful salad. It's got some nice onions, some shallots, got beautiful cilantro leaves and some stems. It's got some great looking cabbage in there, a little carrot for color. What do you think? So we're just going to kind of put this right in our cast iron skillet here. We want to make this look really beautiful. Doesn't that look a little barbecue-y right there, that cast iron skillet? Love this stuff. This is the best way to go right here, make it look beautiful. All right. So, let's go check on our ribs. Let's come on over, okay? Oh, yeah. So, I think you can see the difference between the rack we just put in and the two that have been cooking for a while. One of the things I want to point out to you, if you come down here and take a peek at these bones, see how the bones are starting to appear and the meat is pulling back from the bones? This signifies that these ribs are starting to tender out, okay? Oh, look at that. I don't know, can you see that? That's just pulling apart. I think I'm going to baste these, and I think we're going to pull these out and cut them up. So, again, these are probably 3 or 4 hours in the smoker. I'm basting them about every 30 minutes or so with the barbecue sauce and the orange juice. And then this rack obviously just went in, but I wanted to make sure that you guys could see the end product. So let me pull these out.
So Kent, do you have an amount of seasoning you like to use, or in a while? You keep saying they've been on a while, like,
yeah, well, a while is 3 to 4 hours. You know, they've been on 3 or 4 hours at about 225. So most ribs, to get to a point where they're like, if you can see this, see, that's just kind of pulling out of there. So what you want to be able to do, this is really what I want to show you again. See where these bones are pulling back? The meat's pulling back from the bone. That's what you want to see. When that happens, then you know that the rib is starting to get done. Okay, so let's take these back and let's cut these on the cutting board up here. Okay. All right. Now, I'm going to just kind of cut through these real quick. You know what I forgot to do? I forgot to flame them. Ooh, we need to flame them. All right, we're going to go back on here.
Okay, I just had a good question, and I was actually going to ask the same question.
Yeah.
On the ribs, when they're in the rack, do you just baste that one side, or are you going to flip those over so you can baste both sides?
Actually, what I did is I just baste it when I pulled it out and get ready. I kind of baste it on the back side too. Okay.
So when they're in that rack, they just stay in the rack the one way.
Yeah,
the whole
and
time.
you can kind of right. Come around the back with the brush, no problem. Okay. So let's take a little Devil's River.
Now he's just showing off.
All right, now we got a little whiskey braised Oh yeah, look at that. There we go. All right, now we're ready to go. Shut our smoker here. So I think what we're going to do here is we're going to kind of cut these in slabs, in mini slabs, okay? What I suggest here is maybe two or three bones in a rack. So it's like a mini rack. So what we're going to do is we're going to cut like right here and see what we have is we have like this piece right here. Now check it out. See that? How this is just pulling apart? That bone popped right out of there. Okay. So now we're gonna put that right up on the top here. We're gonna go here. All right. Go right here. Kind of stack these up just like this. And that's kind of the way we'll serve it. And then we have what did I do with my brush? Where'd my brush go? I lost my brush, guys. Oh, here we go. All right. Now we're just going to kind of finish this up right on the plate. Just like that. Look at that. All right. Now that is a nice little plate of barbecue. Now let me just kind of give a little taste here. I'm sure there's a question about how these taste, so I'm about to tell you. I wish you guys were here. They look good. These could actually go a little bit longer, but they are really delicious.
He's not sharing. I'm not sure about this.
You want a rib?
I would love a rib.
Yeah? Now I'm going to toss you a rib. All right. I'm giving her a rib, guys. She better get a towel here. All right. I'm coming around. There you go.
All right, people, I'll be honest then. He's a little...
Now, what I need to know is, are there any other questions while I eat my rib? Those are good.
Do you need to rest ribs?
That's a great question. You could, for sure. For the purposes here, we wanted to get them out and cut them. But absolutely, when your ribs start to kind of pull apart a little bit, if you wrap them, and we wrap in a peach butcher paper that's made for barbecue, we wrap so that in the peach butcher paper, it wraps them and it kind of steams them inside, but it also has enough leeway for the steam to escape, so it doesn't steam them soft, so it allows it to breathe a little bit. But this is really a great way to finish off barbecue, especially brisket, pork shoulders, ribs. Wrap them up. Let them sit in the peach paper for a little bit, have another glass of wine, and enjoy it. Speaking of that, I kind of want to talk about a wine choice here, okay? So my friend Jim Striegel from Red Mare Winery came by this afternoon, picked up some of my spices, but most importantly, dropped me off a bottle of red wine. And I said, I think those will go nice with those ribs. So... Jim's a good friend, good guy in the community, owns a winery out in Napa Valley. The wines are beautiful. And this is what we're going to do. We're going to pour a little glass of red wine to go with this rib. Jerry, what other questions do we have?
I have a few of them here, actually, Kent.
Perfect.
So you said a little bit more time on these ribs, about another hour low and slow, you think?
I probably would say another hour at least, yeah. Yeah, you know, most ribs take 4 to 5 hours on a good day, and you know, I think that they need a little bit more time. But you know, for the purposes of this demonstration, you can imagine the time just flew by.
And pellet smokers, what do you think about pellet smokers?
Love pellet smokers, awesome. Pellet smokers, you know, Traeger is one of the most famous pellet smokers. They're great. They have an auger that just moves the wood pellets down the auger and into the fire. They're really awesome because they allow you to kind of walk away and not have to tend the fire so much. And they're pretty bulletproof. They really work well, and they're well built, and they turn out some beautiful, beautiful food for sure. I'm a big fan.
And where do you get that peach butcher paper? Where would you find
it? You know what? Premier Grilling. up in Frisco, and I do a lot of classes at Premier Grilling up in Frisco, but they have one, I believe, in Southlake, one in Plano. They carry a lot of this kind of stuff. So peach butcher paper for sure. They carry my spices, in fact, although you can buy those at Central Market and at ChefKentRathbun.com. Premier Grilling is a toy store for chefs, okay? If you go up there and you don't have a good time looking around that store, I promise you, you're not paying attention.
And so, if you were going to go with the smoker from the start, would you still use the grill at the beginning?
Well, I probably wouldn't if it was just a smoker, because they're most of the time not set up like that. So the question is, you know, would we use the grill to start? And most smokers are not set up that way, so probably not. But this is one of my favorite ways to cook ribs, because you get that really nice crusty caramelization going on. You get a nice crisp edge to it. And I kind of prefer to refer to these as barbecued ribs as opposed to smoked ribs. And so this is my favorite way of doing it. But I do them both. I mean, I'm not choosy. What else?
How's the wine? Just asking. That's my question.
I should have brought two glasses. And since we're in the middle of the coronavirus, I'm not going to offer you this glass. So I'm just going to tell you that this is delicious.
Does it go with the ribs really well?
Yeah, it's not too shabby.
Is
in fact,
complimenting each other,
I'm
going to
have
really
a bite
well?
Right here.
Okay, just thought I'd ask. Looked good. What was better, the community beer or the wine?
Do I have to choose?
Just ask them, which would you be preferred? Beer and barbecue
like
goes together, but wine's starting to get there.
Delicious. Great stuff. Listen, guys, a couple of housekeeping things before we finish up. Number one, if you haven't checked out the Curbside Barbecue, check it out. I think you'll love it. We're doing some really cool stuff. ChefKentRathbun.com, and just go right through that. And then, secondly, if you want to stay up to date with what we're doing, text my name, Rathbun, to 888-111, and you'll be on my text message string. And then whenever we put up a new menu, whenever we do a new class like this, we promote everything I do on my text string. So Rathbun to 888-111, you'll be opted in, and you'll start receiving text messages about what we're doing. So, listen, man, I hope that you guys have had a good time here. I'm going to be around here for a few more minutes if we have some more questions, and I'm sure we do. If not, Jerry's going to have to ad lib. I got
a few questions.
You got a few questions?
Got
all
a few
right.
Questions. Rib rack, where'd you get that? What kind? Do you have any preferences?
So I have two different kinds. Back in the day, way back in the day, I had some rib racks from the Green Egg. I have a rib rack right now that I'm using. That's from the Green Egg. Also, Weber has a really nice one available at Home Depot. I think you can also go to linksgrills.com and look at all their accessories. But they are really a cool piece. And especially if you're looking at trying to, you know, save some space, because if you lay them all out on the grill, you're kind of going to be out of space. If you're cooking a lot of ribs and you don't have a huge grill, these rib racks are the way to go. Really, really a nice piece.
If you can't find the peach paper, you just can't make it to Premier Grilling that day.
Sure.
Parchment paper, what other?
Parchment paper. Remember now, if you wrap your barbecue in plastic, plastic seals it in really good, and plastic will create more steam, and you'll get a much more tender rib. I mean, you'll get a rib that, like, literally falls off the bone with plastic. And I'm not sure that that's my favorite thing. I kind of like a rib that's got a little tug to it. So if you use plastic, remember, they're going to steam, and they're going to keep that steam inside, and they're going to cook out a little bit more. If you use foil, that's okay. Peach paper, parchment paper, butcher paper. It doesn't have to be the fancy peach butcher paper that you would get in a barbecue store, but you just want to wrap it up with something that kind of keeps some of the heat in and lets it kind of steam a little bit while letting it breathe. That's really important.
And if you're going to do a turkey, because you mentioned turkey.
Yeah.
Doing it the way you said today, the way you did the ribs, how long would you take to cook like a 10-pound turkey?
Sure. Well, so it's kind of hard to tell you how long it would take, but I would tell you that I would want the smoker or the grill to run somewhere between 250 and 275. I would want to, you know, monitor the temperature. And what you can do is you can put a meat probe into the turkey. And here's where you do it. This is really important. I don't know if you know, but poultry, did you know this, Jerry? Poultry, when you cook chickens, ducks, turkey, what cooks the quickest on that animal? You know?
The breast.
The breast cooks the quickest, right? So thighs and legs are the last to cook. So for instance, if you're monitoring a breast of a turkey and you say, I want that out at 155, or I want it out at 160 or 165 or whatever, your thighs and your legs are still going to be not finished. They're still going to be medium rare. They're still going to be kind of rare, okay? The most important thing is to monitor the thigh and the leg right at the joint. And so what I do is I try to stick the probe right down into the thigh joint right by the bone, and I monitor that. And I want to pull it out at about 150, 150, 155, because if you go all the way to 165 with the thigh, you've way overcooked the breast, okay? The other thing that I would definitely tell you is that if you haven't brined your turkey or you haven't brined your chickens when you smoke them, this is the next new thing for you, okay? Just fill up a cooler with salted water that tastes like the ocean, okay? I mean, it needs to be pretty salty, all right? And what you're trying to do is you're trying to make sure that all that water starts to get soaked into the meat, and you got seasoning or seasoned water that's going in there. So it does two things. It plumps the meat up and makes it super nice and moist, but it also seasons it all the way through. So two things. Please don't overcook your turkey, and brine it before you get started, okay? Monitor the thigh and the leg, and try not to let the thigh and the leg get overcooked, because for sure your breast will be overcooked at that time. So hope that makes sense. Happy holidays. They're coming up. By the way, we're going to be smoking turkeys for holidays, so if I can smoke one for you, let me know. What else you got, Jerry?
I was just going to ask you on a few more questions or not, because I can
sure,
do that.
Sure, we'll do a few more questions. How are we doing on time? They told me I was supposed to be at 45 minutes. I'll bet we're there. But I can stay.
We've gone over a little bit.
Oh, that's okay. Well, I'll stick around for a few.
Not long for you, but a little bit.
What? Wow. Okay.
Do you ever use any of your rubs in your barbecue sauce to make your barbecue sauce?
You know, I don't use a lot of the rubs in the sauce. I use some of the properties in the rubs in the sauce. So obviously, paprika sometimes. In fact, I just made a molasses barbecue sauce yesterday. Our barbecue guys, our team did a big barbecue for about 150 doctors and nurses. And by the way, man, we loved cooking for them, and I hope they enjoyed it. We had a great time doing it. And by the way, man, everybody should call your friend who's a doctor or a nurse or a hospital worker or anybody who has put themselves in the way of this craziness to help other people. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So back to the barbecue sauce. The barbecue sauce doesn't have a lot of dry spice in it. It's it's got a lot of onions, it's got vinegar or orange juice or both. It's got lots of garlic, it's got lots of dried chilies. I mean, we're in Texas, so you know, yesterday I bought like, I don't know, 8 packs of ancho chilies. And this time we didn't just put them in and then take them out. We actually boiled them up in some water and softened them, and then put them in a blender and pureed them into a paste. And then we added that to the barbecue sauce. So it came out really nice. Really nice contrast with the molasses and the maple and all the good stuff that goes in barbecue sauce. So,
okay, let's go. I have two more questions and then we can probably...
Two more questions and then we're out.
Okay, for the brine, you ever do a dry brine? And what kind of salt do you use in your brine?
So I think a dry brine is probably somebody referring to a cure. And so when we talk about salt cured, that is a mixture of salt, sugar, different types of spices, peppers. And that salt is actually packed around the meat or the fish. And it's pretty crazy because like literally we used to do all of our own smoked salmon at Abacus. And we would use a whole case of kosher salt to make this cure. and we would pack the salmon sides in, you know, 2 inches deep in this salt cure. A brine is a liquid solution that has a lot of salt, pretty much a lot of sugar, and then other seasonings and spices and chilies and things like that to give it a little flavor. So they kind of do similar things, but they're very different. You know what I mean? So a brine is the liquid solution. A cure is salt and sugar in the dry solution.
And would you do that on the turkey?
I wouldn't do that on the turkey. I would soak the turkey in the brine. And the best way to do this, by the way, a lot of people, you know, let me give you a little trick. Thanksgiving's coming up. You're cooking for 20 people. Your refrigerator's overflowing. What are you going to do with your turkey? Let me tell you what you're going to do with your turkey. So you're going to take your turkey, put it in a cooler with salted ice water, i.e. your brine, and you're going to drop that turkey in there, and you're going to let it sit in there for, you know, at least a couple of days. And if it's salted water and a really good cure, I promise you it's going to still be super cold when you get to it. Make sure and drain it. And if you haven't tried frying a turkey, that's another thing too, man. I love fried turkey. Have you ever had a fried turkey?
Now you're going to a totally different
place. I know, but it's, you, man, I'm telling you, fried. I know. It's like,
now I'm going to get a lot more questions about frying things.
Sorry. You
know, this isn't about the state fair. We're not frying stuff.
So can I recap real quick before we bail out here? You know, we started with peeling off our membrane off of the ribs. We seasoned them really heavily with the barbecue spice, the sticky pig, and my garlic chop salt. We then grilled them a little bit on a low temperature grill. And then every time we turned them, we basted them with a mixture of orange juice and barbecue sauce. The ratio on that is 3 or 4 to 1. So barbecue sauce, 1/2 cup, 4 cups of orange juice or vinegar, whatever you choose. Remember, that's good because it helps you caramelize the outside of the ribs. And you want to do that every time you turn them. Okay. Once they got nice and crusty on both sides, we put them into the rib rack and we put them on zero heat underneath. And we got the grill going to about 250, 225, 250, something like that. And then we just kind of have some beers, watch the game, watch whatever, hang out with the kids, have some wine, have some Red Mare wine. And then, you know, 4 or 5 hours later, we come and get them. I say that basting about every 30 minutes during that period of time is good. And you just want to make sure that the ribs are pulling apart. Then we have our slaw, which is just a bunch of really cool stuff. I mean, green cabbage, red cabbage, carrot, shallot, red onion, super thin julienne green apple, super thin chayote squash, yuzu juice, olive oil, a little bit of steak seasoning. Couldn't be more simple than that. It is really tasty, really beautiful, and it's going to be a perfect pairing with those ribs. So with that, I hope you guys enjoyed this. I enjoyed it. I hope, I can't wait to see this. I hope somebody recorded this for me. Remember, Curbside Barbecue. We are still taking orders. ChefKentRathbun.com. We pick up between 2 and 4 on Saturdays and Sundays at Lover Seafood Market. Text my name to 888-111 and get on the text message. And thank you to The Observer for setting this up. I had a great time. I hope you did too. And happy barbecuing, man. It's summer and it's time to start.